Welcome to City Cinematheque, where the art and pleasure of the movies are the subject of serious discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach film studies at the City College of the City University of New York. Today, as part of our series, Masters of Film Noir, we're presenting the 1944 production by Fritz Lang, The Woman in the Window, starring Edward G. Robinson and Joan Bennett. He's a professor, and she's a, how do you say, femme fatale. And this is a film that has a delicious blend of high suspense and noir dread. We'll be talking about that and a number of other things after today's screening. Joining us will be Professor William Luhr, a noted expert on film noir. Now, visit New York City with Edward G. Robinson in 1944 in The Woman in the Window. Welcome back to City Cinematheque. I hope you enjoyed this extraordinary film noir and certainly a lesson about the dangers of window shopping. Well, there's a lot to talk about in this remarkable film, beautifully crafted, beautifully acted. We have about 30 minutes to do so, and we have returning to City Cinematheque, always a pleasure to have here, Professor William Luhr. Bill's a professor for many years at St. Peter's University in New Jersey and is the author of numerous works, one of which is obviously very relevant to us, which is film noir, a key standard introduction to the whole group of films. Most recently, he's published once again with his co-author, Peter Lehman, Blake Edwards, the film director as multi-talented auteur. I also want to mention that Bill has edited a definitive script edition of The Maltese Falcon and written the definitive book on Raymond Chandler and film. So, Bill, welcome back. Good to have you here.
It's a pleasure to be here, John.
Good, good. So, Fritz Lang is one of those directors you've studied, you've taught, you've lectured about. So, put this film in the trajectory of Lang's career. It's 1944. Who is Lang? Where does this film fit?
People associate him these days with film noir, with dark films, grim films, bleak films, with the heritage of German Expressionism on American cinema. And that's true. However, if you look at his filmography, right, he does Western Union, he does Westerns, he does the Nibelungen, yeah, in Germany. He does The Woman in the Moon. He does science fiction films, all kinds of different films.
Right.
He was a remarkably adventurous guy. And so this is on most people's chart as one of the first films noir. And in fact, one of the things we were talking earlier is at the very outset, you see Edward G. Robinson teaching at Gotham College.
Right.
The way he's photographed from above has slashes of shadow across
him,
which became a cliche during this era that they called Venetian blind lighting.
Right.
And you see it here in a very early mode.
I like the fact that it's Gotham College, which of course many people now would see as like Hudson University in the long running, you know, Law and Order. You can't name a particular New York university, but I have to just brag a little bit that Edward G. Robinson was a City College graduate, whom we can be very proud of in the City University of New York. So why begin with that scene, do you think?
It establishes Robinson as prestigious, as somebody who's got he's an assistant professor, so he's got a mid-level, right, authority in society,
right,
and things pretty much go downhill from there.
Right.
You know,
right,
so
yeah,
he's, and he goes to his club, right, and his club is 10 blocks north of this studio. It was 44th Street and 5th Avenue. So we see Robinson at the outset of the film as somebody with a prestigious job, as somebody who goes to a sort of upper class club.
Absolutely.
With prestigious buddies like the DA.
Absolutely. And the other buddy who is a physician. So he's actually, in one sense, he's their equal in terms of, you'd say, professional training and cultural capital, but he's also, in a certain sense, their poor cousin in terms of the material rewards and how he would be positioned. Although his study in the film is a rather nice study.
Basically, you see him unravel from there. And by implication, what about the other guys? You know, in other words, that we know nothing about the DA's life, about Raymond Massey's life,
right.
But, and then the physician. So there's the implication that virtually anybody in this prestigious mode in New York can have this dark confusion, disaster behind them.
Right, and that's, again, that comes back to one of the central, tenants, as we think about film noir as a group of films. It's what scholar Tom Gunning has called the destiny machine. That once you engage with that alternative path, it just takes you, and as it were, in many cases, for no good reason, or for a foible that is modest, and the punishment, the retribution, the situation seems so disproportionate to the minor incident, initiating incident in some way.
Yeah, which is an ideal way of describing this film, because the Robinson character just kind of stumbles into talking to the woman whose picture is in the window,
right,
and then he stops for a beer. They go up their apartment, not that he's really expecting sex.
Right.
And then suddenly her secret lover crashes in, and it winds up in a knife fight with Robinson, and Robinson kills him.
Right.
And so suddenly Robinson's in this thing, what am I going to do? And I've got to get rid of the body. You know, so he's involved in things for which he had no preparation, and finds himself going from a sort of bland middle class existence into a gothic horror.
Right. Though, which is not to contradict you at all, his lecture is about homicide and murder. So his point of view is very much the legalistic one about this. You know, what is the appropriate thing in terms of legal procedure or definition of crime, etc., which is completely the opposite. That kind of intellectualized, and I say that descriptively, version of it is completely different from what you've just been describing as the experiential immersion in it. You know, I mean, what kind of crime is this that was just thrust upon me in some way?
It's also that the arc of the film,
okay,
is intriguing, because I cannot get away from thinking of this in direct relation to Scarlet Street, which comes right after this film.
Okay.
And it stars Edward G. Robinson and Dan Duryea and Joan Bennett. And it ends in a much grimmer fashion.
Right.
Because this one ends with first a kind of joke where you see him committed about suicide and all of that. And then suddenly he wakes up and it's all a dream.
Right.
And then he goes out to look at the picture in the window again and sees an image of a woman, just as with Joan Bennett at the beginning, behind him.
Right.
And his response is, ah, and he runs down the street in terror. Right. Well, with Scarlet Street, it closes not with at all any kind of joke,
right,
or way of denying what's gone on before, but in fact, the whole thing has led him systematically into madness. And so you see him wandering down the street, wandering past the picture in
right.
the window, and he doesn't even recognize it anymore. So he's, and the Dan Duryea character in that film winds up going to the electric chair.
Right, absolutely, yeah.
And so it's a much harsher, more brutal film.
I'm interested we're already talking about the ending, because it's something that almost everybody wants to talk about this film, because there's this question of, you know, is this really an appropriate ending to the film? It ends really on a comic note, as you just pointed out. And a number of commentators have said, well, obviously this is something, you know, imposed by, at this particular moment, by the production code, etc. And Lang's response to that was, no, actually no, because I really wanted to get him firmly outside of the dream, and how would he respond in real life as opposed to in this dream state that we didn't really know was a dream state for a long time. Yeah. Even though there are, you know, touches. I mean, that moment when he first, you know, emerges from the club and sees her, and we actually have the, you know, the triple image. I mean, he's looking at her. There's the painting. There's the reflection, and then all of a sudden, there's the materialized. It's not just a reflection, which, you know, can be a play of light or whatever. Then there's a materialized woman, and that's in retrospect, in a second viewing, that's a very strange moment. It's almost as if you're entering into this dream state that's going to have.
Yeah, well, also having Dan Duryea as the doorman.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, Dan Duryea is this sinister, creepy guy in the body of the film, and then suddenly seeing the same actor, but as the sort of servile doorman.
Well, yeah.
And you get this doubling throughout the film.
Well, absolutely the case. And it's worth bringing up, I think, at this point, that there's this is a moment just preceding World War II, during World War II, and immediately following World War II, in which, for a variety of reasons, but one of which is simply the arrival of so many Central European immigrants fleeing the Nazis in the United States, you not only have all of these remarkable talents, people like Lang and Ulmer and Siodmak, whom we're also screening in this series, but you really have Central European psychology and particular psychoanalysis landing, you know, not only landing in the United States, but making its way into the popular culture and an awareness of that. And this is a film that very strongly plays upon, I think, that kind of interest.
No, it's an intrigue because, I mean, this is the decade during which the image of psychology and psychologists, because he's a professor, assistant professor of psychology.
Exactly.
The image before the 40s of psychologists was largely of weird Viennese bearded guys talking to one another and let's talk about sex, you know, talking about stuff that would repel presumptively the American middle class. And then we get psychologists in the 40s and film after film as normal, helpful, paternal, avuncular guys helping out, almost never women, but guys helping out their patients rather than imposing sinister sexual views on them.
This is a professor of psychology who knows about these things, who knows about criminality, who knows in these ways, and this kind of fatal fall, as you've already been pointing out, can happen to him too. Just knowing about these things does not constitute protection from them, because we're all vulnerable in this particular kind of world. So, what about this film? I find this film to be, for me, a very interesting mixture of something that is always mixed in noir, but is mixed in, I would say, different ways or different proportions, because certainly there's a lot of suspense in this film, but there's also a lot of dread in the film as well. And I think those are different things in some way. But I mean, we're really, you know, Lang pumps up the suspense in something like, how do you get the body out of the apartment in the middle of the night? What can go wrong, in that?
And when it goes wrong, I mean, and when it goes right, it starts to go wrong. In other words, because when he sees the police guy or the DA, and do you want to check out what a crime scene looks like? Let me drive you up there. And when they get to where he dumped the body, suddenly he says, boy, you know this area pretty well. And what's that ripped from your jacket? You know, so they find a piece of cloth from his jacket. So it seems like, okay, I've gotten rid of the body, thank God. Oh, my problems are over. And they're not. They come creeping back in.
Well, and that's this way in which there's a challenge. The plot, once you get into what we now know is his dream, but it seems to be his linear experience, But within that linear experience of that, there's this, and I think you describe it very well, there's this kind of spiraling effect of things going out of control. And I think you put it very well. Just when you think there's a solution to something, the solution turns out to be, you know, another problem, which includes, you know, Dan Duryea, one of the greatest of all villainous characters in American cinema, and a distinguished actor as such, well known as the absolutely nice guy, leader of his son's Boy Scout pack, you know, that. But when he goes slimy, he goes slimy. And what's interesting in terms of narrative structure here is that he doesn't show up for a very, very long time. It's after the body has been disposed of, et cetera, that all of a sudden there's this, you know, it's the district attorney says, oh, yes, and what we discovered is that, Mansard's people had a detective on this. And so all of a sudden you have this, it's almost deus ex machina, this new villain who shows up. And just underlining your point of the kind of inescapability of this, just when you think we solved the big problem, here is another big problem that, you know, leads in the direction of, well, from, you know, defending yourself directly from being attacked, I mean physically attacked, to plotting his murder.
Plotting murder, yeah, because when the only way to get rid of a blackmailer is to kill him, you know, and suddenly you see this milquetoast guy plotting murder,
right,
thinking about murder,
right,
and as well as very soon thinking about suicide,
right,
and the movie is moving in such grim directions, and then suddenly we get this inoculation at the end. It was all a dream,
right?
That's most intriguing, and I suspect a lot of that had to do with the awareness of the production code,
right.
And yet he didn't have that kind of inoculation at the end of Scarlet Street,
right,
coming right after. And it's almost impossible not to think of the two films paired and of Lang moving in a darker direction.
One of the threads always discussed about film noir is the role of women within film noir and their relative agency in different films, and what kinds of agency that, that is. So let's talk about the Joan Bennett character, Alice Reed. So what do you make of her in this film?
Yeah, she's contradictory, she's intriguing, she's clearly attractive, and virtually every man who comes across her is drawn to her.
Right.
She was obviously in some fashion, the mistress of the guy who quickly gets killed. Exactly how she fits in with the Dan Duryea character, we're not really cued into. Clearly, he starts to talk to her, well, would you like the police to come and check this whole apartment out? Would you like to? She goes, who does? But that sense of Dan Duryea realizes what's emanating from her potentially.
Right.
But then also the fact that she turns him down and says, well, but going to Europe, and also that she's about to poison him.
Right.
And he sees the fact that she offers it too readily cues him that, no, this is, I don't want to do this.
Not kosher, as we might say.
I mean, and her, she's could hardly be more opposed to Robinson's wife.
Right.
Because
thank you for bringing this up. Yes.
His wife and family at the beginning, and this normative middle-aged grouping.
Right. Absolutely.
So that everything is settled, nothing is dangerous in that packing.
Absolutely.
And then we see with Robinson, it goes downhill from there.
And it's very interesting that there are, in a certain sense, there are three women in the film, two very minor. But they are this incredible contrast. On the one hand, you have the wife who is presented, you know, as we used to say, as very plain. She is de-eroticized in every possible way in terms of costuming, makeup, the casting, et cetera. She seems almost more grandmotherly than motherly in terms of the age of the of the children. And so, as you just pointed out, now they're going away to Maine, you know, for the summer, and this is completely regularized. So you've got her who, it seems, you know, there is no charge left there, et cetera. So then going to the third character, which is the obvious prostitute at the end of the, you know, of the film. And then the Joan Bennett character gets to stand in between as this ideal fantasy that she's, that she's a mistress, but she's not cheap, you know. And of course, as you pointed out, that exact arrangement, both in terms of narrative, of what the arrangement is, how does she have this apartment? I mean, you know New York apartments. I know New York apartments. Yeah. You know, he drops by two or three times a week. And so it seems like she's perhaps did not get, she's had other, the implication is there, that. But there's that ambiguity that also serves the production code. In a certain kind, it serves the narrative, but it serves the production code at this particular moment. And then she becomes, you know, when we break point of view with him and we're with her, I think you're absolutely right. We don't know, wait a minute, whose side, she keeps moving ambiguously from side to side.
I mean, she has no agency of her own in any real way, except for the fact that she knows she's desirable,
right,
that men are going to surround her, and she can get men to do what she wants to an extent.
Right. No. And I think a very good example of that is her, what we call the initial seduction that takes place on the street when he's looking at, and she keeps querying him. And she says, you know, and she even says, are you afraid of this? Or, you know, and she taunts his masculinity
expertly.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
no,
knows
thank
what
you.
What buttons to push.
Absolutely the case. So let's talk a little bit more about this film as noir and its style and its use of space and that. So what else strikes you about how this film, you know, uses space and the city and the apartments and all of that?
Well, perhaps the most, aside from her apartment,
right,
where we have the, well, it's the main space of the film, what we constantly return to is the street outside.
Thank you.
And Lang comes from Germany,
right,
where one of the central tropes of German Expressionist film was what was called a street film, in which a lot of what's going on and going dark within society happens on the street, where the people meet, bounce off one another. The street has a life of its own.
Right.
And the constant returning to the street outside with somebody getting out of a cab. And for no obvious reason, Dan Duryea is taken care of. He goes out to the street and suddenly he's dead.
Yeah.
You know, he gets caught in the middle of this thing. So that sense of the environment of the street outside the apartment, which is also where Robinson and Bennett meet,
right,
outside this portrait. It looks bland, it looks plain, but don't trust it.
Right.
Something's going to happen, and it happens to Dan Duryea. It comes close to happening to Robinson at the end.
Right.
I mean, one further reflection on what you was asked about before, it's very perceptive about the film, but in terms of the role of women,
uh-huh,
and it's hard not to think of Lang in terms of how he deals with the women in his different films, and to jump a decade ahead and think of Rancho Notorious. You know, where you have a Western dominated by women, which is just wrong in terms of, you know, in terms of the presumptions of the genre. And so you have Lang's mind thinking, how can I twist this all around? How can I do something that you shouldn't do with a Western? Put a gun on a woman, you know.
Well, you know, and that brings up this larger, you know, observation about Lang that you really began with. And that not only is Lang, you know, this variety, but multi-hyphenate in terms of his skills in dealing with different forms of storytelling with different genres, but he both creates, expands, and alters genres. He's one of those people. I think you've just given the perfect example of this, of, wait, you... You can't have a female-dominant Western, you know, particularly in the 50s style, which is clearly not an accurate historical representation, but is a highly stylized form of storytelling. But he does that. In Metropolis, we have, obviously, visions of the modern science fiction city that, you know, anticipate issues that we are all familiar with from, say, Blade Runner from 40 years ago. So this again is just following what you were saying, something like his use of the street here is something he is importing from these German films and implanting, you know, this particular treatment of the kind of dread and the unpredictability that are out there in the nighttime street. And that we do, I don't think we confused with the naturalistic street, because Lang was so precise in terms of composition and lighting that there's, without it stopping the image, there is a, you know, painterly quality, but the painting is expressionist in its touches.
And the linkage of expressionism with the lurches that his career made.
Right.
You think of the early 20s, he's doing The Nibelungen, two films from this grand, historic, mythic German epic. And then he goes into Metropolis, this futuristic science fiction thing. And then he goes and does M, you know, which is centered on this one lost, desperate, perverse guy.
Serial killer.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And to recommend for those of our viewers who have not had the immense privilege of seeing M, and to talk about Lang in these ways, I mean, M is one of the great and initiating films of both police procedurals as in film and also of the villainous serial killer of some complexity and of this moral conundrum that we have of both being attracted to someone, just the procedure of what the person is doing, and then also the chase in finding it. So, you know, again, Lang is the person who brings all of this into the Hollywood studio system in 1940, with all of its restrictions. Yet at the same time, he refreshes it all with his vision.
I mean, one thing about film noir is the way in which once film noir started to appear in America around this time, after, you know, a couple of years after Double Indemnity, and it's hard to define film noir. It's a moving target.
Because, I'm going to have to stop you. Oh. We're going to have to stop with the question. What's the moving target? Film noir, because we've run out of time. But it's a great place.
Okay, fine.
If you've enjoyed our discussion here today, please join us in following weeks when we'll be talking about other films, other film noirs, and other films. How do you know about that? Come to our website, www.tv.cuny.edu. Bill, always a pleasure having you here. Look forward to our next discussion. And thank you for joining us today as we explore film noir. And please join us in the future as we continue our stroll through the archives of film history. Bye for now.